and this is mainly as a result of additional grant funding and staffing efficiencies, and that's within the Early Health and Prevention Service. Within the Neighbourhood Directorate, they are forecasting an improved position this quarter of £265,000 as a result of external funding that's been utilised for the Community Safety and Transport Team, and also an improved position in Parks and Environment, and this is relating to additional income from hitch hire, but also the reduced cost of regulatory services. This is unfortunately as a result of continuing difficulty to recruit staff, which is what we're seeing across the whole of the council. Within the Resources Directorate, there are favourable variances being reported in the HR and OD team, and this is mainly as a result of reduced training costs, as a result of more training take-up being online rather than face-to-face, and this is cheaper to be provided. There's also been the ability to charge some further staff who are working on capital schemes to the capital programme. This is releasing revenue within the digital and ICT service. And also an improved position is being reported in the Revenues and Benefits Service. And this is as a result of the early implementation of a pilot service review, which is looking at implementing digitalisation and automation. And that is actually being implemented now in advance of the delivery of the current savings next year. So the RCM efficiencies being delivered actually in this year as a result of that. In addition to some of the more favourable variances, however, there are a couple of worsening positions at quarter three, and these are mainly within law and governance. While they're recruiting to posts, the work is being covered at the moment by locums, and these are generally more costly. And also there is an adverse movement forecast from quarter two within regeneration and place departments, and this is mainly within the planning section. I think you'll see within the directorate summaries, it is clear that there is still a significant impact that COVID-19 is having on the council's finances. And this is forecast actually in some areas to continue into the future, into next year. Section 3.10 in the report does detail the additional COVID funding that was received at quarter three. And a full report will actually be brought back to the committee with the outturn report in June, which will identify all of the COVID funding that we've received, the expenditure incurred on COVID activities, and any future commitments that we still have planned. In general, I'd say, Chair, the additional governance and scrutiny has been put in place to ensure that we are only spending on essential areas across the council is working well, and obviously this is evidenced by the improved positions at the end of quarter three. Just with regards to the savings proposals that were agreed this year at full council last March, as at the end of December, so the end of this quarter, 98% of these are on target to be achieved, and 13% of those are actually being achieved by other means. There's lots of details in the report, actually, Chair, that is provided within the relevant sections relating to the individual directorate for quarter three in their summaries. And the recommendations in the report are to note the forecast at the end of quarter three, note the reduction in the capitalisation request, and also note the additional COVID funding that's been received within this quarter. Thank you, Chair.
I invite questions or comments now. Councillor Green, you've got your hand up.
Thank you, Jeanette. Yeah, just a couple of... Can I also, well, I'm sure others will, commend officers and members for taking care of spending, for making sure that spending was only being spent on that which was essential. activity limit today, we won't actually be finished paying for them by 2047. So, have we aggregated up what the level of capitalisation of salaries is for in this year and future years? Because that's going to be an ongoing, that has an ongoing revenue implication if it has to be covered by borrowing for some considerable year. So, have we aggregated up how much capitalisation? I'm talking about the budget going forward, because we're aware of that, but the amount of capitalisation of salaries that we've used, and have we aggregated that? So we have an indication of how much borrowing we're doing to maintain revenue services at the moment.
We will have done that, yes, because it does need to be included within the capital programme. And for new bids that come into the capital programme, we do specify that people identify this separately, so we can actually do that. I don't have it with me, but I can get that figure for you, because we will have done that exercise.
Yeah, thanks. Thank you if you would share that.
Thank you, Chair. The report mentions in some places the issue of earmarked reserves, where the reserve at the start of the year and the reserve as it is expected to finish the year are set out. I think it would be helpful if, whilst it's quite true that members of the Finance Working Party Subcommittee have questioned officers about reserves and been through pages of lists of reserves, and asked for information and been satisfied with answers, it would be better, I think, if all this documentation about earmarked reserves was actually put in a file and sent to members with explanations, so that it's all in one place and that we can be fully satisfied that we are doing the best we can with the reserves that we have to maintain the services but also be prudent.
As I understand it, Councillor Gilchrist, that a file has been sent out with a list of all the reserves with all the descriptions. If you've not received that, apologies, but I'll make sure that you do receive that.
I have had that several times as a member of Finance. I'm not sure if all members of the Council have had that detailed documentation with the budget papers so that they can satisfy themselves when we set the budget in a week or so's time.
Sure, I can make sure
that's
sent out to all councillors.
That's a really good idea, Councillor Gilchrist. I don't see any other hands up, so I'm going to move that we agree the recommendation. So I have a seconder. Thank you, Councillor Gilchrist. Are we happy to agree the recommendations? Okay, thank you. Move on to the next agenda item, which is, bear with me. Agenda item 7, which is capital monitoring quarter 3, 2021-22. Again, Chair, if you want to take us through that.
Thank you, Chair. Yep, so as we just mentioned, Chair, this is an update on the capital monitoring report for quarter 3, which at this quarter presents a revised capital programme of 71.9 million. And this is a forecast, a reduction in the forecast spend from quarter 2 of 5.6 million. The reason for this mainly is a significant reduction in schemes in three areas, and this is shown in the report in section 3.13. It also includes a reprofiling of expenditure into next year's, as highlighted in section 3.3. But there's also been some additional spend forecasts within regeneration and place this quarter, which is stated in section 3.5. Within the report, section 2 highlights some of the updates on the major schemes in the programme within directorates that are progressing well as a result of this quarter. And as already mentioned, the report contains information on the reprofiling of schemes that has gone into future years. And this can be for a number of reasons, because the scheme is delayed, there is a lack of capacity to deliver the scheme, or there is another reason, for example, awarding of contracts. And this is why some schemes will be reprofiled into future years. The report also contains information on new grant-funded schemes and the new bids for each director are included in the recommendations into the capital programme for this quarter. I just mentioned in the previous report on revenue monitoring, section 3.6 in the report talks to the reduced value of capitalisation for this year. And the reason that it appears in the capital programme is that there is a need to borrow to actually fund capitalisation, and that's why it falls part of that programme. There have been some violence included within the report this quarter to schemes included in Appendix 3. And this is where there is a necessity or request for some additional funding for some schemes, and that can be actually reprofiled or taken from some of the schemes in the capital programme where funding to the extent that it was originally included is no longer needed. I just wanted to draw also members' attention to section 3.8.2 in the report, which highlights the revised guidance on restrictions for borrowing from the PWRB or the Public Works Loan Board, which specifically prevents borrowing primarily for yield. And I just wanted to make members aware that this does not apply to any of the council's current schemes that we have in the capital programme. The appendices included within the report detail the movement in the programme between quarter two and quarter three by individual scheme, the significant variances on the schemes that have happened at quarter three. As I mentioned, the full detailed proposed requirements that are recommended for approval this quarter, and also provides a full listing of the capital programme as revised at quarter three. The recommendations of the report are to recommend to the full council to approve the revised capital programme, to approve the additional funding for the new schemes, and also to approve the requirements that are listed in the appendix.
Do you have any questions or comments? Councillor Cleary?
Yes, thank you, Chair. I've got a couple of questions. Just referring back to the previous question from Councillor Green about the capitalisation of salaries, we've got the reduction in the capital spend as outlined here in Table 2. So would that reduction in the capital programme, would that more than offset, or would it offset, or to what extent would it offset the degree to which we're capitalising salaries? So therefore, if we're thinking about the long-term implications of interest payments and capital repayments, how would that kind of all come out in the wash, so to speak? The second question, in the CIPFA report, it refers to a recommendation around the disposal of sufficient assets to obviate the longer-term need for borrowing under the capital direction. So, given that we are now expected to capitalise even less funds than we were previously, does that then follow through to a direct reduction in the amount of assets that we are expected to sell off to fund the capital capitalisation?
Thanks. Thank you, Chair. I think in relation to your first question, Councillor Cleary, so any reduction in the capital programme, so in the spend that we have forecast in the capital programme, potentially will reduce the borrowing that we have required to pay for the capital programme, and this will cascade into the revenue monitoring, so any reduction in interest that we actually have will actually be a reduction in revenue spend as well, and that will, as I say, feed into the revenue report. And where that has happened, we have actually forecast that into the quarter three revenue monitoring report. There's not always in terms of timing differences, as you can see that in the report there is some additional funding, additional spend in some areas, and that will tend to be offset by where we've actually reprofiled spend into future years, or where we have reduced actual capital expenditure. But where there is a general reduction in the capital programme, that does forecast and that does reduce the revenue spend, and that has been forecast into the revenue monitoring. Just in terms of your second question, which is about the reduced capitalisation value, so you're right, DLUHC have actually given us an instruction that we would sell assets, dispose of assets and generate capital receipts to pay off our loan for capitalisation. At the time, obviously, that was higher. Now it has reduced. There will be a reduced requirement for us to sell assets. So we would only sell the equivalent of assets to the equivalent of the loan that we take out as a result of capitalisation. So as that decreases, the value of asset sales will decrease as well.
I don't see anyone else with their hands up or wants to ask any questions, so can I move that we agree the recommendation was here for the seconder? So, thank you, Councillor Carroll. Are you happy to agree by assent? Okay. move on to agenda item 8, which is budget 2022-23 and the medium term financial plan. Page 5 to 444 in your report. So before I ask Chair Hale to present this, I'm going to allow discussion after the report has been presented by Chair Hale. Before I move to accept the recommendations of the officers, I'll be making some alterations to the recommendations on behalf of the Labour Group. Thank you. You have to come in, Chair.
Thank you, Chair. So this report recommends a legal and deliverable budget to the full council at its meeting on the 28th of February for next year, the year 22-23. It is a lengthy report. It does contain multiple appendices, and some of which of these are required to be published as part of the statutory annual budget process. The report describes the process that has been undertaken throughout the year to get to this point where we are in being able to recommend a budget to full council. The report follows on from the information provided to the January committee, and in that report it detailed the funding provided from government to support the budget as part of the draft local government funding settlement. We've now actually received the final local government funding settlement, and I can update the committee this evening that very little has actually changed as a result of that final settlement. We are very slightly better off to the tune of around about £1,000. However, this was to be expected. Very little does change between the draft funding settlement and the final funding settlement being published. So as a result of the final funding settlement being published, there are no real changes to the report, and no real changes have been made to the content of the report following the update for that settlement for this evening. The report contains specific appendices that are relating to the discretionary rate relief policy, to the setting of council tax, and this will be subject to a separate vote at full council. The school's budget, the schedule of fees and charges, which will also be updated following approval for any increases included within the budget proposals, and the updated medium-term financial strategy and medium-term financial plan. Following the inclusion of all the savings proposals and the review of pressures and growth items, the budget is now currently reporting a surplus of income over expenditure to the value of £444,000. And recommendation 4 in the report included is to transfer this surplus into the council's general fund balance. Appendix 2 provides proposals for savings and income to be included within the budget, and these proposals have undergone a rigorous and robust scrutiny and challenge process this year before they've been allowed to be included within the budget. This process has been both an internal and an external process, with some additional scrutiny provided this year by the Chartered Institute of Public Finance and Accountancy, or CIPFA. Appendix 6 provides a list of pressures and growth items that have contributed to the budget gap, and these pressures and growth items have also undergone a rigorous challenge process to make sure that they can be evidence-based and as robust as they can be at this time. And as a result of these two items that are contributing to the budget, in Appendix 1 is included a report from myself as the Council's Statutory Section 151 officer that confirms the robustness of the figures and the calculations included in the report tonight. Within my report, I've highlighted to the committee how I've reached the conclusion and includes my opinion of the levels of reserves and balances that I consider the Council should be setting aside to ensure any unforeseen cost risk and any unforeseen non-delivery of savings risk is mitigated as far as possible. And to this end, the general fund balances will be increased to 13.2 million in 22-23, which is 4% of the net revenue budget, and this doesn't include the proposed transfer of the surplus at the year end. There is also an establishment of a new additional contingency report of £3 million, and this is specifically to offset the risk of any delays in the achievement of savings or any areas beyond our control that mean the savings cannot be made next year. However, my report also highlights the risks within funding uncertainty and the changing social and economic conditions, such as demand increases, the continuing impact of COVID-19, increasing costs such as escalating energy prices, and any changes that may happen to legislation. We still await a comprehensive spending review from government, which we understand will be available within 23-24. And with this, the potential risk of the end of the 100% business rates pilot, at which the time of entry into that pilot was actually financially beneficial to the council. And as a result of that ending, it is expected that this will reverse and may actually cause a recurrent pressure. Whilst in the absence of any comprehensive spending review, we can estimate what our future funding assumptions would be, but this can't really be done with any real certainty, and this makes planning really difficult. Any of the items that have mentioned, which is actually not an exhaustive list, could have a detrimental impact on the stability of the budget, and therefore it will be vitally important that timely and robust monitoring of the budget takes place to ensure that where we get any indication that there may be a potential issue, and mitigating actions can be identified and implemented quickly to ensure the budget remains on track. The main report highlights the ongoing actions to be undertaken of the monitoring of the budget once approved, including a new strengthened scrutiny and challenge process. And this will be reported in the report that comes back to this committee next month, that is meeting on the 16th of March. The report seeks to remove over 18 million of recurrent costs out of the council to ensure it can remain on a secure financial footing for the future. This is in response to the recommendations of the Deluxe reports. This has been achieved with a collaborative cross-party approach, specifically as mentioned by the committee's finance subcommittee, who have been meeting on a weekly basis as a working group alongside officers to develop the options to be put forward in the proposal this evening. There is still more work to be done to ensure the council can present a balanced medium-term financial plan, and the report refers to how this will be achieved with the establishment of a change programme which will seek to implement service reviews across the whole council over multi-years and to ensure the services the council provide generate beneficial outcomes and demonstrate value for money. And I mentioned in an earlier report where a pilot is being undertaken with the Revenues and Benefits Service, which is already generating benefits ahead of next year's proposal. I did say at the opening, Chair, that the report is lengthy, does contain several appendices. I'm not intending to go through them all in detail, but I just wanted to highlight the key points for members to note this evening. And there are 7 recommendations in the report, and some of these contain multiple elements. So I'm just going to pause there, I think, Chair, and open it up for discussion. Stuart is here as well, who, as you know, has supported the whole budget process throughout and has worked closely with the committee. And if there are any specific questions, we're happy between ourselves to identify
So I'm going to open it up to questions and comments from colleagues. I'd just like to start by saying that this has been the toughest thing that I've faced as a politician, and I know that it's the toughest thing that I've gone in this room or so has. I personally welcome the removal of the proposed increase in residence parking permits. I thought it was very unfair, I thought it was penalising people who can least afford it, people who can't afford to have driveways and garages. Personally campaigned on that one, so I'm pleased to see that's not in our budget. I'm also really pleased to see that our school cost control people will be retained as they provide a real vital service to the community and are much loved and valued. As I said, there is a series of alterations from the Labour group, which I will walk through after we finish this discussion. Tom, you had your hand up.
Thanks, Joe. As you already said, it's been extremely difficult for all members and officers to go through this budget. It's no comfort to those people who use those services that are on the table tonight, but people have been working to look at those cross-party and engage constructively. From my perspective and my group's perspective, we have changed our governance structure in the council. We are in a committee system. It is our responsibility to set a balanced and legal budget, no matter how difficult that is, and some tough decisions do have to be made. It was said earlier, I think, by Councillor Bird that Wirral is only one of 11 councils in the country to go through a capitalisation directive, which means you have to go to government to ask for money to support our day-to-day spending costs. We can only use earmark reserves or reserves once are used. We can't use them again. It would be really easy, as the council has done in the past, to say, oh, we can identify a couple of million from this pot here, and then next year we'll be in an even worse position. terms of different pressures. So that's not something I think we should do. I think it would be irresponsible. And I think as councillors across policy in our working groups, we've agreed that. Chair, I do have additional comments, and I would like to make additional alterations to this budget in due course, or as you yourself.
Councillor Gray, do you want to?
Thanks, Chair. I am also going to say that I appreciate how much work has gone into this. It's good to see some things taken off the table, and I'll echo what you said about those school crossing controls. I'm relieved and delighted to see that that's no longer on the table. It's something that residents feel really strongly about. It's something that the constituents here feel really strongly about as well. When you read the business case, you see that the risk isn't just financial or reputational, it's children's safety and lives. It shouldn't be on the table, and I'd really like to think that that was never going to be on the table again. It's off the table now, which is a good, because it's a life-saving service. So it's a really wise decision, but I'd like to think that we don't have to do that again, that it's not going to be on the table again. It's unfair on residents, it's unfair on families, and it's not appropriate having declared a climate emergency when we're trying to get people walking and cycling to school. So I'm really relieved and delighted to see that's on the table, and I just want to celebrate that. Thank you, Chair.
Councillor Tony Jones, then Councillor Paul Stewart, thanks.
Thanks, Chair. I'll use Councillor Gray's words. I'm relieved to see that some of the proposed closures for public conveniences have been removed, particularly in the coastal zone. I'm sure elected members around the table fully understand and appreciate their substantial need and the part they play in supporting our visitor economy. So, for fear of repeating myself, Chair, I'm relieved as well. Thank you.
Councillor Paul Stewart.
Thank you, Chair. I just want to echo both yourself and Councillor Anderson's comments with regards to the serious situation we find ourselves in. I've said this before at previous meetings, but you know, I'm happy to say it again, that I'm sure politically all parties in the past have fought for their own reasons and their own values to retain services and to prevent the loss of services and cuts to services, and we've done that by finding money figuratively down the back of the couch, taking money out of reserves, and we've come to an end of a line. Can no longer do that. We are now in a position where we are facing potentially government intervention if we don't get our house in order. And that has come as part of the recapitalisation directive, and that has, you know, been highlighted in the independent reports as indecision. But I'm sure that there's nobody in this room tonight, and no elected member, that will apologise for resisting making those serious cuts in the past and trying to protect services and our public.
have been able to see what the figures are, question, discuss and debate some of those issues and test some of the elements within them. I think it's been healthy, and again, you know, since the time of the introduction of the executive system, I've not experienced such a collegiate approach to a shared problem. And I think Paul put it best when he pointed out the real problems the council is in. We're not out of this yet. We have to put the council's budget back into a proper condition that we can then use as a platform as a local authority, hopefully, to build on. But I would commend all parties that have been involved working with officers to actually get us to this point where we're at the stage where we're proposing we will be proposing a budget to council for council to make a view on. And I know there will be a series of amendments and so on and so forth, and that is good and proper, I believe. My concern, if you will, is around the savings that have been identified. Are we sure? I know £3 million has been put to one side in order to for any problems with delivery. As I intimated a bit earlier when I was looking at quarter three, one of the key things in that was that there was a series of savings that weren't being achieved, and we were actually mitigating them by capitalising salaries or using reserves or a range of other elements. So, and if you went 12 months back even further, there was a whole tranche of savings that were meant to be achieved that was written off because they were considered unachievable. So I'm quite interested, Chair, through you, Chair, is what rigour are we bringing into the change programme and the change process that will mean this time we will have learned the lessons, that there won't be a, you know, repeating of history where we missed a series of things that need to be saved and they don't get saved. So, so through you, Chair, one of the questions I have is what rigour is going to be in place this time to make sure that this change programme actually delivers, as opposed to a range of change programmes that we've said we've had that haven't actually delivered. Thank you.
So, Councillor, if I may, if I'll answer first and pass over to Chair. So, as members know, the business case proposals went through significant challenge, not only internal challenge, but CIPFA challenge, to provide that external verification over the deliverability and also to provide that assurance to the independent panel. The independent panel met informally on Friday and were reassured in terms of the deliverability of that £18.5 million, albeit recognising the challenge of that presents. You'll be aware as part of the subgroup that the steward with the supporting members put aside the £3 million deliverability fund. It is fair to say the independent panel sort of indicated 15%, but that's £3 million, not 15%, and they recognise that is there to allow for challenges in that deliverability. Ideally could have been more, but I'm happy to recommend that we go with that. The conversation that both she and I had with DLUC yesterday, this is Carol in the chair of the panel, was that this is a robust budget. What we need to do now is bring forward, as Chair has indicated, the proposal of the next P&R of how we're going to manage that change programme. And I see certainly the role of the subcommittee continuing in both these two things. First is setting the budget for next year. So hopefully by the next round of committees before we go into recess, we'll be looking at next year's budget. The other part will be the deliverability of that budget, of this year's budget that we're going to agree. Start to agree tonight and going forward. So the committees will have two roles in that, and the subcommittee will oversee the delivery of that. The change programme is up and running. As we remember, Tim Gaines, the AD for change, brought that change plan to PNR in December, and we've already begun to deliver on that already, but that will provide continual updates to this committee and to the subcommittee.
also, it's one thing wishing we make these and believing we work. The other thing is having the commitment and rigour to make sure it happens. And I just wonder what the additional rigour is going to be to make sure that we actually achieve it as well.
Okay, so I also now meet with directors since becoming chief exec, and we've really focused on that this year. Hold directors accountable on a bi-monthly basis against their financial savings and against their delivery plans under their financial plan, which is what we've begun to see this year at Mass. The programmes of work will now begin to take root in the organisation, and we will use the relevant forums, both officer and member forums, to ensure that visibility of those change programmes. As I said, the committees in particular will be responsible, and particularly the chairs around this table, to ensure the committees get hold of those change programmes and make sure they're delivered in those service areas.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Councillor Gilchrist.
Thank you, Chair. First of all, grateful that there was throughout, I think, 20 odd meetings of finance, certainly PNR, members in private, the discussions we've all had have produced the list of savings that aren't being taken, where members express great relief over some of the issues. I have spent time working through those, but I don't want to remind members that we've been here before. Some of us have been here before. I was looking back at 2012, when a decade ago we were in the same situation, and we had outside financial advisors came in and looked at us when we were predicting a 13.2 million overspend in October 2012. So the situation isn't new, but I'm satisfied that our attempts to get on top of things are much better. The DLIP report we've looked at many times, the Ada Burns and the SIPFA report, often said that members have been reluctant to accept proposals that might have an adverse impact on the provision of services to the community. It has been entirely true for the last decade, because as members, what we try to do is keep as much running as possible. We try to respond to the needs of residents. And when we've had our finance subcommittee meetings recently, what I think we did was look over the edge of the precipice, look over the edge of the cliff, and back off from some of the savings that looked really difficult to achieve or would, as I said previously, undermine the fabric of society. But the key thing we need to look at, first of all, if we haven't been given the additional funds for adult care, which is temporary, we don't know how long they'll last, they may continue, but we've got those, but if we haven't had those, the situation would be horrendous. The second thing I want to ask about, or offer, is that we go through this process, and out of it, something better has to emerge. Hopefully, better ways of keeping track of our spending, but more importantly, being able to go through this period of pain in order to offer some hope that things will improve in future years. And that's why we need that longer-term funding settlement from government, because we're living from year to year, and we can't plan ahead. So I'm hoping that when we look at capital and future, we will put some money aside, because at the moment there's 660,000 in the leisure capital line, and we know our centres are ageing. The second element is that we have that 440,000 or so that we might add back in. And I think the key need now is for us to have a transition to help those groups that may want to take on community asset transfers. I have sent an amendment about that round early today, and we'll probably come to discussions on that later. So I'm hopeful we go through this period but emerge stronger, perhaps leaner, but providing the things in a pattern that's going to be stable for the future, and that includes libraries and sports centres and facilities that we all value.
some questions as well, and also some additional proposals when the time comes. So the challenge, as we all know, has always been to put our finances on an even keel without inflicting unnecessary social damage. So the question uppermost in my mind is, given the circumstances we face, does this budget strike an appropriate balance between financial prudence and social impact? And I've said before, we don't want to go from passing budgets that contain unrealistic savings plans to ones that are so excessively prudent as to cause unwarranted damage to the people who elect us and who work for us. So to that end, I've been reviewing the high-level figures that have evolved ever since we received the external assurance reviews of our finances. So our overall savings, as has been mentioned, were originally set at 27 million. We were told at the time that the financial settlement from government was unlikely to significantly impact on this number. In the event, the settlement improved our position by over £12 million. And only at this stage were we told that there would be an additional pressure of a 15% contingency applied. Now, similar to the pattern we saw last year, the capitalisation amount, again, as we've heard earlier, needed to fill the budget gap, has dropped back from 10.7 million at the start of the year to 6.3 million today, as income has exceeded expectations. And this will be the 10th year in a row that actual income has exceeded budgeted income. The process has brought an increased and welcome focus on our reserves. Our general fund or rainy day reserves are too low, that is well acknowledged. And it's welcome that 2.5 million will be added to these. But that does beg the question why this wasn't done several years ago in the light of concerns raised by the auditors. Furthermore, it would be surprising in my view, given that there is still ongoing interrogation of our earmarked reserves, the £70 million of earmarked reserves, that some of that could not be further reprofiled to significantly reduce or even eliminate this year's capitalisation and all of the benefits that would flow on from that. And again, I think I would repeat what's been said earlier, that all councillors need better information and detail on our earmarked reserves so they can be properly scrutinised and appropriately profiled for the benefit of the whole council, not just individual directorates. And I would say that given the proposed reprofiling of reserves already indicated the £2.5 million, it's no longer necessary to devote the proposed budget surplus of £450